Hello from the Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar, AI and the Future of Work, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association, the McDonough School of Business, and the Georgetown Technology Alliance. I'm Sarah Smith, Senior Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's webinar. Thanks very much for being with us. I'm pleased to begin today's session by briefly introducing our lineup of Hoya panelists. Flynn Coleman is an alumna of the School of Foreign Service, class of 2003, and is the author of A Human Algorithm, a narrative on the urgency of humanely designed AI and a guidebook to reimagining life in the era of intelligent technology. Dr. Maggie Little is the founder and director of the Ethics Lab at Georgetown's Kennedy Institute of Ethics and is a professor of philosophy. Her research interests include issues in reproduction, clinical research ethics, data ethics, and the structure of moral theory. Fabio Rosati is an alumnus of the McDonough School of Business, class of 1987, and parent of three Hoyas, classes of 2016, 2018, and 2023. He is an internet entrepreneur who is best known for his work as CEO of gig economy platforms Ilance and Upwork, and as chairman and CEO of the hourly work platform Snag. Dr. Jason Schlotzer is an associate professor of business administration at Georgetown's McDonough School of Business. His research examines how executives collect and use information to motivate employees and evaluate firm performance. Our session is moderated by Paul Almeida, Dean and William R. Berkley Chair for the McDonough School of Business. His strategy research focuses on innovation, knowledge management, alliances, and informal collaborations across organizations and countries. He's interested in understanding how knowledge builds across people and organizations and how this affects performance. He is the father of two Hoyas, classes of 2016 and 2020, and has been a member of the Georgetown community for more than two decades. He has served Georgetown McDonough in a variety of capacities, including as Deputy Dean for Executive Education and Innovation, as Senior Associate Dean for Executive Education, and as Professor of Strategy and International Business. He has taught students at all levels at Georgetown McDonough in the areas of strategy, international business, technology, and knowledge management. For further biographical information on each of our speakers, please reference the bio sheet in the handout section of your GoToWebinar control panel. Please note that today's session is being recorded and all registrants will be able to view the recording later on the Alumni Career Services YouTube channel. Finally, if you'd like to submit any questions or comments for our panelists today, or if you have any technical issues during today's session, please send those directly to me via the questions area of your GoToWebinar control panel. Now, without further ado, I'm so thrilled to hand it over to our moderator to begin our discussion. Dean Almeida, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Sarah, and thank you to our wonderful panelists for joining us virtually today for a discussion on artificial intelligence and the future of work. At Georgetown, we believe that the world's most complex issues can be solved at the intersection of disciplines. And so this interplay of business with medicine, with law, technology, policy, very important. At the McDonough School of Business, we're focused on preparing students and really the broader business and policy community for the fields of the future, including analytics, technology, and the future of work, business and global affairs, sustainable business, and the business of healthcare. Anyone who joined the workforce when I did in 1985 experienced work in a very different way than we do today. Actually, even if you joined the workforce 10 years ago, you did that. But technology is advancing so rapidly, and it's going to only accelerate in the future in terms of our personal lives and professional lives. Just over the last 9 months, we can see how technology has positively affected our lives and our work environments. We probably couldn't imagine where we'd be just a year ago, but just think about the acceleration of technology intensity and the far-reaching consequences it's going to have. And that's why we're here today, to understand technology, particularly AI, and the role it's going to play for us, for our colleagues, and actually for society as well. And we must explore the ethical, the policy, the social implications of advancing technology in our lives. We should be asking questions like, how can AI enhance job creation rather than just replace jobs? How can AI's position in business serve those at the margins of society? I'm pleased to share that Jason Schlotzer, who was just introduced to you, will be leading Georgetown McDonough's efforts in this area, including developing new courses and experiences for students. And we're pleased to collaborate with Georgetown Alumni Career Services and Georgetown Technology Alliance on this webinar. So why don't I just jump into the first question, which is a broad question, really, you know, about the buzz around AI. And since Maggie is at the top of my Hollywood Square screen, why don't I start with her? So Maggie, Mark Zuckerberg, and so many others think that AI is one of the most exciting things about our future. And there are others who are worried. Elon Musk, Henry Kissinger, you know, they fear actually for the future of civilization as we know it. So I was wondering, who's right and why?
Oh, start with a tiny question, Paul. Okay. I guess I would say they're both right. I mean, in terms of potential. So AI has enormous potential for good, including the common good and the social good. Advancing our ability to respond quickly in the face of pandemics, for instance. Many of you will have seen the headlines about DeepMind, which is a subsidiary of Google, coming out with having solved the protein folding problem, which is for anybody, I do a lot of work in bioethics, for anybody in medicine is just such an exciting idea. So proteins work, they're just a string of amino acids, but then they bundle up and assume a three-dimensional shape, and that's actually what determines their effect on the human body. But we haven't been able to figure out how to go from knowing the string to predicting what the shape is without sometimes decades of experimentation. Now they're doing it in minutes. So this is my mind-blowing emoticon for you right there. So in just enormous promise, and yet it also has enormous peril. If it's not done responsibly, with understanding of its potential implications, with those who develop, deploy, and use it, having an understanding that they have a huge responsibility to be thoughtful and careful and in their decisions, like any other tool, could be used for good or bad. And you, if you're creating the tool, you're responsible for what you can imagine might happen with it. So the idea of needing to have conversations like this so that we understand socially responsible AI is really critical.
So, you know, Maggie or anyone else, are we on the right trajectory of taking this responsibility seriously for minimizing the potential bad and maximizing the potential good? Or are we still early on and we're not quite sure which direction we're going to take?
Jason. I would say how many people can define responsible AI? And that would give an indication of how seriously are we taking the issues around how these technologies can positively or perhaps negatively impact society. That would be my take on it. And if someone can't define responsible AI, you know, caring about how humans and AI are going to interact, caring about issues around transparency, around what AI is and is not doing, how do we make technology less important than people and actually putting people first? Until we have more of those types of conversations, then I'm going to say we're at a very early stage on whether we are grappling with this issue of AI in a serious way.
Flynn or Fabio?
I would echo what Maggie and Jason have said, and I think there is, as there has always been with technology, a real binary obsession with the Terminator robot Arby's are going to kill us all or it's going to save us all. And part of why I wrote my book and part of why these discussions, as Jason so beautifully said, are so important is there are all of those opportunities in health, what DeepMind just did, some very dangerous threats, but also very insidious threats. AI is no one thing. and it is infused in our lives in myriad ways. And inequity and inequality, not just in the digital divide we're seeing the pandemic, who has access, but in terms of who's responsible for the technology, is that just the programmers? It's also those who invest. It's also a capitalist system that focuses on quarterly reports. So technology is built for profit as opposed for purpose and for those, you know, social good metrics that we need. And so it's a complex web. And I think it's so important, as Jason was saying, not just to understand and learn about coding and programming, but it's all about humane and ethical leadership. It's the people deciding how these technologies are going to be used, from our criminal justice system to education to agriculture to aviation. So it's going to take all of us working on many different facets. And I think what's so key and what I always like to say about AI and just generally is no one of us has all the answers. And we need to be having these courageous conversations across disciplines and industries so that together we can figure out how to use this technology responsibly and for good, as opposed to otherwise. Because we're primitively grappling with these issues, as Jason said. I mean, we're very new in that field, but at the same time, we're at a crossroads, because once you build something that's exponentially smarter than you could be or you could ever be, we, in a sense, kind of like climate collapse, become past the point where we can start to figure out how to fix things. What we really need to do is figure out how to infuse values and compassion and empathy and justice into the tools themselves.
I agree with virtually everything that has been said so far, and I often think of AI as electricity. It's everywhere. It's so powerful. It affects everything, every job, every life, the way electricity did when it came out. But when electricity was first deployed, we made lots of mistakes. We caused a lot of harm, unintended consequences. And over the years, we developed the safeguards, the standards, the electrician's licenses, all of the things required. We're at that stage today. And the good news is that we are still dealing with what's called narrow AI or weak AI, which is pretty limited in its purpose and capability. It helps us do things like, you know, power. It's behind Google search. It's behind Netflix recommendations. It's behind predicting proteins. But it doesn't have that strong AI or super AI capabilities that people who look ahead 10, 20, 30 years ahead get worried about. The Stephen Hawking's and the Elon Musk, they think about what will happen when AI is so powerful that it's smarter than us. And given that we're dealing with narrow AI, the solutions are, I've been thinking about what would be the types of things that we would want to see. And at the top of the list, it's transparency of purpose. Right now, there's AI in almost everything we do. We don't even realize it, but there is no transparency of purpose. Why am I being presented this item when I click on Amazon? Why am I being presented this content when I'm clicking on YouTube? Transparency of purpose should become a standard. Every one of us should be able to click and understand what the purpose of the technology that I'm using is for. The second thing is bias. We'll talk more about bias, Flynn, you touched on that. The potential for goodness is huge with AI to really eliminate bias, to really create equality, but it's also simultaneously huge in terms of amplifying existing biases and carving out and eliminating opportunity for people. So if we can say we want transparency of purpose and we want to have transparency of bias and develop the capability of assessing the AI for bias, we would do wonderful things. And I don't think it's that far from being implementable. I suspect in the next year or two, we're going to begin to see corporations adopting some standards, and we're going to begin to see government adopting some standards, because we're getting to the point where we have to, and people are sufficiently understanding it. Hence, for example, the conversations that we're having now. So I'm optimistic.
So that's what I was going to ask. In general, are most of you optimistic that we're heading in the right direction in terms of this balance?
Maybe I'll jump in there. I just finished teaching an undergraduate course, Introduction to Ethics, where we talked about the pandemic, racial reckoning, and divided democracy. And one of the questions we asked throughout the whole thing was what concept of hope we have, because those are all very challenging and concerning issues. And one of the things we did was distinguish between optimism and hope. So I do not have optimism, which I think of as being relatively predictive, right? Like your question, Paul, about are we really on the right track? Can we have some confidence in the path we're on? I don't think so. And I'm not trying to be depressing, but I don't. I think it's so complex, and so many different factors will determine how we do. And I don't know that, well, we don't have the AI right now to predict how we're doing, but I do think we can have hope, right? And reasonable, appropriate hope that we can start finding pathways forward, in part because we really need to.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I think that the regulators and political types have been behind in understanding what these tools do and what they're capable of doing. I mean, I think earlier this year, when you see that people in the government finally realized that maybe it wasn't a good idea to allow Google to buy DeepMind several years ago, clearly they're way behind the antitrust potential, around that decision that occurred. But maybe they're waking up, and maybe, there'll be some thoughtful leadership that comes through around the policy area, either collectively through businesses, as Fabio was saying. Maybe they'll develop their own codes, or maybe, it's going to happen through regulatory agencies, perhaps in Europe, driving what the decisions that are made in the U.S. about data usage and data portability, and people being able to opt out of being shown or interacting with certain types of systems. Maybe it's something to pay attention to in the next 2, 3, 4 years to see if we start waking up to these issues. But I think when you hear the negative types, the Musk saying that this is going to be disaster, I think they're focused on the idea that people aren't paying attention, and this is going to get big, fast, and we're not going to be able to control it once it's already out there.
Go ahead.
The issue is, without the safeguards, if it gets into nefarious hands, it can be very harmful. And the reason I say that I'm optimistic, I believe that the kind of conversations that we're having today are happening more broadly, with more people understanding and clamoring for more transparency. And I believe the private sector, some companies are going to, and have already started embracing the responsibility. And by doing that, I'm hopeful they'll educate the remaining consumers on what they should expect and set standards. That doesn't mean that we won't have bad actors, because we always will be, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And just to add to that, as a war crimes and genocide attorney, obviously I've seen the worst of humanity. But just to add to what everyone said, it also means I've seen the best. There are people around the world, brilliant people, from students to activists working on algorithmic justice to working on responsible technology. So at the end of the day, it comes back to not just diversity, but radical inclusion and representation and humane leadership. There are people working on these issues. There are people that have been working on social justice, human rights, transparency, accountability for many, many years in many areas. So it's all about being radically inclusive and having conversations and having more seats at the table for more diversity, inclusion, representation, and having that moral imagination, because there are people working on this around the world, in the global South, people that have been dealing with bias and discrimination across technology, across space and time. My students give me hope, people that are working on this. So much of this, like anything, politics, business, is having that kind of having the wider lens and being willing to say that it's so critical that we are radically inclusive, and that our politics, our leadership, our businesses, our tools represent the prismatic diversity of all of us, and including learning from our natural world, learning from solutions, to problems that have been solved around the world. And so opening our eyes to that is critical. I mean, when Fabio talks about transparency, I think about, I'm sure, something Maggie thinks about every day, how we're developing vaccines. I read somewhere that something like 15% of all code is shared.
Whereas for sequencing genomes and figuring out how to get a vaccine in a year's time is a real miracle if scientists and technologists and people learn to work together with ethicists, with professors, with people across across different industries. So solutions are there, and hope is there if we know kind of where to look, but also if we're willing to come up with solutions and be have that moral imagination to really reach for the stars in a way that's not just building something, but building it for good.
Thank you. So I like you, have some hope, but depends on my mood. Sometimes I'm just filled with trepidation. So let's, the topic for today is really relating AI to work and the future of work. And I'd like each of you to answer this double question. So if there's one concept or idea or fact that you'd want our audience to know about AI and the future of work, what is that? Just if you say, take away this one thing, what would it be? And maybe the second part of the question is, what are you most excited by? Where is their greatest hope? Where is their greatest potential in terms of the future of work, particularly? And since we started with Maggie, why don't we start with Jason this time?
So I'm going to be a little contrarian here, and it's based on quite a bit of thinking around what this future of work is going to mean with the development of this initiative at the McDonough School. And I'm going to say that the most important thing about AI and future of work is not technology, it's leadership. And recognizing that now more than ever, we need leaders who are very purposeful about what they're doing and how it impacts people in society and people inside the organization, other employees as well. So if I'm going to ask somebody to take one thing away from this discussion, I would say, remember that leadership is extremely important. Then I'm going to say, what am I excited about? Well, I'm an academic, and I'm excited about the technology. I think it's amazing what some of these tools can actually do and the problems that they can solve, how they can be applied in research or how they can be applied inside the business to solve problems and to serve customers. So, you know, the most important thing is leadership, and the thing I'm excited about is the technology itself.
I'm not sure why that's contrarian. Leadership, one would expect that. Right?
I would think that many people logging in for an AI and future of work discussion are going to think that AI is the most important thing in the future. And I just want to make sure that people remember that, in my view, it's not the most important thing. Leadership continues to be the important thing.
Thanks. Flynn?
Indeed. So echoing what Jason has said, and of course, obviously, from my remarks, very passionate about not just leadership, but humane, ethical leadership, and figuring out how we can be more inclusive in that crucible of who gets to lead. And I think for the future, I think one thing I'll add to this conversation is there is a lot of focus, and of course, it's a massive business, on forecasting what's going to happen in the future. So some reports or some people or some tweets will say it's going to take over all of our jobs, whereas the new McKinsey MIT report said actually jobs are pretty safe. You know, others say it's really just going to take over discrete tasks within our jobs. And all of these are part of the discussion in terms of what we're facing now, mass unemployment. And so for me, what I'd like to suggest, in addition to what others have said, is like the global pandemic, this is an opportunity. And in fact, we must reimagine our societal constructs, our infrastructure, to be thinking about things in new ways. Because on the one hand, some people have Zoom fatigue. On the other hand, almost half the world through the digital divide doesn't even have access to reliable internet. We're talking about the future of children's lives, the future of education, of who gets to be included in this crucible, who is going to get jobs. So we need to be reimagining how we treat the most vulnerable and marginalized society, how we're raising and educating our children, how we're figuring out how to have trust in science and not just building the vaccines that are going to save us next year, but how are we protecting wildlife habitats so that we can figure out how to, you know, stop future pandemics. It's really widening that lens to be thinking about the future of work in terms of partnership with AI. What I want to say about that is AI is coming whether we like it or not.
whether it's going to save us all, hurt us all, what form it's going to come. It's going to be different in every industry, but it's coming. There will be people that are using it for good. There will be people that are using it for bad. So how do we partner with these machines? How do we help, you know, them help us take over some of these mundane tasks so we can become more creative explorers, so we can have different types of adventures, different types of jobs, empathy trainers, to be thinking about how we connect with machines in better ways, reimagining the workplace, reimagining how we work with science. And I think this idea of reimagining is so critical. We're seeing it as our democracies are in serious peril. We're seeing it as we face pandemics and climate collapse. How are we learning to work with each other and with the machines that we're building, the intelligent machines that we're building, to build a brighter world? And just, you know, to add that that includes not just the technology, but how are we working within an economic system that only prizes some types of tools, right? And some types of companies. We need more social entrepreneurs in the mix so that we're coming up with things like, for example, the company Sage came up with a gender-neutral virtual assistant. Whereas before, they had all had women's voices. And we need more voices in the conversation to be creative in those types of ways too.
Great. I find it interesting. You know, I study collaboration, and we find it hard to collaborate with each other or with institutions. It's kind of interesting. You use the word partnership with machines now. So that's a whole new field for me to study as soon as I give up my deanship. But Fabio, what do you think? And after that, Maggie.
Yeah. The one thing for all when I think about AI, I think problem solving. If there's one word, you ask, what's the word? Problem solve. What problems can we solve that we're not solving? And we'll talk more about it in the next section of the conversation. But the thing I'm most excited about today, at least, is using AI to eliminate bias. I think that we worry about AI amplifying bias, but we actually can use AI to eliminate bias, and we can use AI to eliminate bias in recruiting by basically eliminating all of those factors in screening candidates and deciding who we should interview in an organization that are known bias-driven criteria. We can eliminate those and use the technology to make sure that we have a more equitable interviewing process. And there's a company called Eightfold AI. There's another one called Hired Score, which is, by the way, founded by a Georgetown alum, Athena Karp. These are companies that are trying really hard to use AI for good in the recruiting space. There is AI and bias in lending. There's a huge problem today where minority-owned businesses, Black-owned businesses are not getting nearly as much of the credit and lending that they should. Because of bias, and it's a known fact. It's not even up for debate. Well, AI can be used to eliminate that bias and make lending more equitable. There is bias in social services. There's a fascinating study in Nassau County, New York, where Child Protective Services is responsible for deciding which children are going to be pulled out of families and put in foster care. And based on historical data, they were collecting racial information and addresses and a bunch of other things that really biased their decision. This child is at risk. And when you looked at the data, it was shocking, but there were way more. There was a whole bunch of white people making decisions and almost always being biased in who to pull out, which child to pull out. When they started to strip out all of that data, the results improved dramatically. Huge change, much more equitable process, and the number of children that were being pulled out of specific demographics dropped tremendously because the bias was eliminated. So that's what I'm really excited about, to use AI for those purposes.
But Fabio, at least early on, we were very worried because of the way the data that was used, that it would actually increase bias as well. Do you think we've passed that point?
The bias... So this is it's a little bit like if you use an amplifier in music, if you amplify something that exists, you're going to make it bigger, right? Sound more. But AI allows you also the opportunity to select the data and eliminate the data in the decision making that goes on in your mind. It creates an objective assessment of how a decision should be made, which today is made by human beings with implicit biases that don't even aren't even aware of. I know that I have biases I'm not aware of, but if I use data and I'm confronted with it, I'll discover that somehow I end up hiring the same type of people from the same type of schools, and all of a sudden I'm aware of it, and I can rely on a screening process that tries to mitigate that. So it really, it's about intention. AI allows us to become more objective and more equitable if we use it properly.
And Maggie, I know you've dealt with a lot of these issues for a long time, but of course, I still want to know what you're most excited about.
Oh, so I can't even think because I'm so fascinated by what Fabio and Flynn just said. So can I just respond to that instead?
Of course.
So I just love, Fabio, what you said about that data analytics, including new organic data analytics, AI, have shown the light on existing human bias in so many ways that are known to the people who experienced it, right? But not necessarily known as well as it should have been to the rest, to others. And I applaud what you're saying about AI can be a helpful tool in combating bias. I also want to remind the audience what Fabio said at the start, right? Which is AI can ensconce bias. So thinking about having
transparency,
Yeah, exactly. And a sort of bias auditor, right? Just as we have standards now for accounting practices, we need to have standards for bias auditing. And it's not enough, of course, just to say, well, it's an AI tool, so it doesn't have bias, because it matters what data it's trained on, what questions you're asking it to solve, and what your accountability process is. You know, so test it and see what the results are, and then need to see where you need to tweak. That's why I want to come back to what Flynn said about radical inclusivity. So when people have talked about how to combat bias in AI, there are some developing standards on how to have good integrity with your data and the like. But one of the most important things to do to combat bias unintentionally being introduced in the way you're engineering or even figuring out how to make informational sets out of organic data is by what Flynn says, which is who's amongst the design team building that tool. If humans build a tool, they'll notice the worries and the potential dangers that resonate with their own life experiences. That's just how humans are. Okay? So if you have all the same type of human, which if you look to see who are the coding engineers, right, there's some worry about how much diversity we have in that profession. Okay? If you have too little diversity, an overrepresented demographic, and then especially if they've still got, which many people of course are getting over, but if they've still got the culture of move fast and break it, which is the opposite of what we need to be doing here, you'll have safeguards against some kinds of biases, but I promise you, you won't have safeguards against all of them. So rather than just telling that same demographic, work harder at noticing potential bias, you actually need to have diversity amongst the people who are building the tool.
I think that's a great point. Completely agree. That's why I applaud things like AI for All, these initiatives that are trying to include, make AI more accessible so more people participate in the conversation and in the creation of those tools.
Yeah. I mean, just if I can just add one more example, I remember very early conversation. I mean, this is all moving so fast. So it wasn't that many years ago, but it feels like forever ago in AI time. And I was at a convening at Georgetown Law School talking about the use of predictive analytics by government agencies, which were including predictive policing and predictive sentencing. And it was fortunately a highly diverse group in terms of discipline and race, ethnicity, gender, all sorts of stuff, inside academia, outside academia, NGOs, industry people, just great. Okay. And the conversation was going in one direction about what we should do. And then one of the participants, who's a Black man, raised his hand and said, "I just need to tell you, I'm terrified. I'm terrified that the way we're using predictive analytics in policing and sentencing right now is going to increase racism and hide it more." It was a double-edged worry. It's going to be more racist and less apparent, because people would say, now I'm just looking at numbers. So just going back to what Fabio was saying at the very beginning about transparency and auditing on some of these issues is, some people are talking about starting registry of algorithms and AI tools when they're very human impacting, not just your Spotify necessarily, predictive analytics, but when it's really being deployed to make decisions on people's access to what a philosopher would call the fundamental goods of citizenship. And I don't mean legal, illegal, I just mean member of a community, right? Your access to employment, housing, education, your accessing to political voice, your access, all of those sorts of things. If you're using a tool that's curating people's access to stuff, we need to be able to audit it and see if it's okay.
Great.
I'd like to talk a little bit, I think the bias issue could take several webinars. And again, I see both hope and I see a reason to worry. You know, Maggie, as you said, people will say this is what the data shows and this is what, and hide behind that to some extent. So it could accelerate and even accentuate bias. In terms of AI and the workforce and employment. I was at a conference some time ago, and I think it was, they said Microsoft's 8,000, I'm not sure it was Microsoft, it was one of the big tech companies, salespeople now don't have to do any forecasting because the AI tools can do much better. That's going to save hundreds of thousands of man hours. They can concentrate on sales. But what came to my mind is, what really is the implication for hiring? And, you know, how many new sales jobs will they therefore be? So, Fabio, you're very close to this. Given the interaction of AI with employment and the workforce, which jobs, firms, and industries are going to be affected most and how?
So it's very interesting. You know, there's a camp that worries about many jobs being eliminated. Yeah. I think I'm on the camp that the majority of the jobs, if not all jobs, will be changed, will be transformed somehow, one way or another. Whether you're a farmer using AI to make you better at predicting when to apply fertilizers or herbicides in what quantity, whether you're a doctor or a nurse making more precise diagnostics and prescribing more accurately, there's all kinds of data that shows that the combination of a very experienced team of doctors with AI technology can improve diagnostics from 94% to 99.5% in Massachusetts General Hospital. There's all kinds of examples that basically say this tool, if used properly, and we all agree that's the big thing, if used properly, can solve many, many problems. And it can solve problems that we experience on a daily basis. How many of you have had experience calling a repair person, I should say, shows up in your house and didn't bring the parts. They knew that the refrigerator was broken. They knew the brand of the refrigerator. They knew
yesterday,
the chance.
By the way.
Yesterday. And like, yes, I knew, but I didn't have it, so I came up anyway. That kind of inefficiency can be completely eliminated with equipping our processes and our people with AI, because it will basically say, you're going to Maggie Little's house. Here's the information we have. You're most likely going to have to bring this, and this. Don't bother until you have it. Saving time to Maggie and not wasting time to the repair person. There's so many examples where AI is going to be helpful. Educators can use AI to become better at what they do by studying the behavior of students, by analyzing more data on what content works better and getting feedback. So the power is immense. I'm very optimistic. That again, you can tell that I tend to be a glass half full kind of person. I'm very optimistic that it will actually enhance a lot of the jobs that we do. And your example in Microsoft, it's interesting because I've worked with lots of salespeople, and they absolutely hate forecasting. It is totally arbitrary. It's tedious. They don't believe in it anyway. The most of the time, they game the numbers, because they're embarrassed of saying in front of all of their colleagues what their numbers are going to look like. And so why not automate, use data and predict more accurately? It's a huge thing. And now they can use that time to sell more and therefore make more money for themselves, which is a major driver for them. So I'm optimistic that we can use the tool for more productivity, more job enjoyment, et cetera. There are things that we should worry about when we get to a point that people are not able to learn the new process. We'll get into the whole reskilling and education later. That's probably the one thing that we got to get right in addition to building the right technology.
Yeah. Flynn, you know, you've written a lot about, you know, the less fortunate. How will AI hurt some of their jobs and their livelihoods and the approach? Will it provide opportunities? How do you see it?
Well, as Fabio is speaking, and as we're sitting here in the midst of a global pandemic, massive unemployment, major issues with everything from sexism to racism to ageism to ableism, the digital divide is growing ever still. So again, in the hands of a very select, homogenous few technology giants, we're talking about AI. For almost half the world, we're talking about a lack of reliable access to the internet, let alone food, jobs, dignity, respect, access to education. And these inequities and these inequalities due to the pandemic, I mean, for example, COVID has hastened progress in women's rights. It's hastened progress for the rights of children to have access to education. So when we're talking about AI, again, we're not just talking about coding and programming. We're talking about all the ethics around it, the bioethics that Maggie works on. We're talking about education that Jason is working on, that all of us work on. We're talking about access to this infrastructure, this basic infrastructure, this basic, dare I say, human right to digital access. You need that for banking. You need that for education in a pandemic. And so much of this comes back to who gets to be radically included, who is in charge of making these decisions, because AI does have so much transcendent promise. And it's this incredible, I mean, for me, what's so fascinating is AI is a mirror for who we are. It mirrors us. The technology we build mirrors us. It mirrors our biases, both conscious and unconscious. And so in terms of the future, there is so much hope, and there are brilliant people working on this all around the world, but it's all about access and agency alongside the transparency and accountability. And that's not just accountability in terms of working around black box algorithms. That's accountability for who's on your team, who's on your board, how safe of a space are you providing in your classroom for students to learn? And reskilling and training is incredibly critical. But for me, it's our responsibility as a society to provide access. Because the other thing in terms of problem solving that Fabio was talking about is we won't be able to solve the problems of society without reflecting the diversity of all of us. That's where our best ideas come from collaboration and thinking about, as Maggie described, and is something I always say, the lived experiences. I could never know your experience. I could never know someone else's experience, even though my life's work is to think about human rights and social justice. And technology has been around as long as humans have. Fire is technology, irrigation is technology. So in terms of the future, this access and opportunity is critical, because as has been discussed, AI is no one thing, and it's going to be different in every different sector. And I think in the future, it won't even be called AI. It might be virtual intelligence or augmented or digital intelligence. And so I think that what's so critical is that I'm very concerned about inequities and inequalities and this widening divide. Mm-hmm. And so we need to be talking about these basic ideas, pipelines to access, because that's where the best problem solving will come from. And nothing could be more urgent in our times than thinking about that. Because in terms of something like bias, Maggie and Fabio were discussing it a bit. When you have more diversity, more radical inclusion in the room, that's how you solve for bias. I always say there's so many things we can't solve. There's even AIs, right, that are talking to each other and their developers don't know how they came up with their solutions. But having more people in the room and recognizing that's important, that's something we can do.
Maggie, in terms of AI and COVID, I'm sure AI played a big role in the vaccines. I don't know enough about this. Do you think the advent of COVID has accelerated the influence of AI in industry, in firms, in our lives, or is it pretty neutral?
Yeah, I mean, I do know about, you know, a couple of cases where AI was used to I don't know, it might have been used with some vaccine stuff, so I don't have those stories, but in trying to find sort of therapeutics, there was a great AI company that ran AI on actually a natural language processor on the scientific literature on extant drugs to see which ones might have markers that the AI system thought could make it useful against COVID-19, which is really, and they found one, and it's one of the ones that's now been approved for use with COVID, one of the treatments. So that's really, really cool. But can I go back to future work for a second? I keep wanting to go off on from what Paul has asked me to do. So I think I'm more pessimistic about AI in the future work. I'm really sorry. So I agree with Fabio that it's very, very likely to have a strong function of increasing the quality of work experience and the productivity of work done in almost every job. That's consistent with saying, and it will eliminate millions of jobs net. Yes, it will also produce some new jobs, but and what's the time span on which you don't that you net out positive? So the transition cost of, I mean, look at as Flynn was talking about the unemployment now with COVID, I don't see a non-bumpy road on the future of work. I'm sorry, I don't. I mean, I just think about self-driving vehicles, right? So is it 500,000 trucking jobs?
There's 2.3 million in the US trucking jobs. 2.3 million. Okay.
Yeah, that's a lot. And all of those people aren't going to get retrained and work in tech. That's just that. I don't get that. So I'm concerned and just want to distinguish the claim of it improving some jobs, maybe all jobs that remain extant. It will make some new jobs, but will it net out, especially in the short to medium term, like for 20 years? And if we have even more inequality, that's a threat to just our communities in general, not just those who are on the bottom of it.
Yeah. With all technological change, we tend to say in the long run, but the people don't live in the long run necessarily. And that's where, and we'll come back to retraining and reskilling in a little while. I have a question for Jason. Jason has often added the word dignity when talking about technology and the future of work. And I just, Jason, I'd love to hear why the concept of dignity belongs there and why it's so important in the context of the future workplace.
I mean, so I talk to mostly large multinational corporation executives. And so a lot of my worldview is shaped by what I hear the uses of artificial intelligence or advanced analytic tools inside of those organizations. And it's very, very easy to sit around a conference room table and talk about operational excellence or talk about improving efficiencies or, to kind of summarize Fabio's view of the farmer and the doctor and the salesperson, you're creating more expert humans. Think of the person inside your organization who's the best at their job. And wouldn't it be nice to have everybody be that person, create more expert humans inside the organization? And we don't always think about, well, how is this going to impact, the people that work in this department? And do we know those people? Do we know their life stories? Do we know what they're facing? And do we really understand how this technological change or how this tweak in their job is going to affect them as a person? We often see it as just a discussion about improving excellence, and we don't think about it as changing people's jobs or changing people's home life. You know, there's even evidence that disruption at work creates disruption in the home life. But we don't think about that. And I think when I use the term dignity, I want us to think about that. I want the students who come through Georgetown to be able to not just look at, does this save cost or does this improve sales? I want them to think about, how is this going to affect the employees? How is this going to affect society? And that, so when I use the term dignity, that's what I'm driving at. People come first. I think, I've been involved in business now since, the mid-90s. And I feel like we've lost the fact that people come first, and it's turned more into the fact that profits come first. And at least for Georgetown in this area of discussion, I think it's important for our students and for Georgetown to project externally this view that people come first, and we should not lose sight of that.
Thanks, Jason. And this is a good segue to an important issue, AI and ethics, which we've actually been talking around for much of this conversation. And we also brought up the idea of retraining and reskilling. And so a simple question. So we all know that's going to be important. We all know that historically, society has not been incredibly good, especially in the short run, at retraining and reskilling. So whose responsibility is it? Is it the governments? Is it the individuals? Is it the organizations? And how do we achieve a better outcome? And I think Fabio or anyone who would like to talk about this.
I'd love to pick that up if it's okay. And to follow up on what Jason said, first of all, I couldn't agree more with Jason's life perspective. Business, and not to get into outside of the topic of AI, but capitalism has gotten, it's kind of lost its soul. It's happened gradually over the last few decades, or maybe it's always been there, but now we're paying more attention to it. I don't know, because you could argue that 100 years ago, it was still had lost its soul. I think that we have to move to a place where boards, shareholders, managers, people in the position of influence and power in business, all take accountability for stakeholders more broadly, which is people, but it's also the environment, for example. There's many factors that we're overlooking in the name of profit, and it's wrong. I believe that. This is directly relevant to this issue of AI. AI is an incredibly powerful thing. It's as powerful as electricity. It's an industrial revolution scale change happening under our very eyes at this very moment as we speak. And it will make lots and lots of people, lots and lots of jobs different. It will drive reorganizations. It will drive process change. And therefore, it will put employability at risk for many people. Now, we can have endless discussions about whether the net number of jobs created will be higher or lower. And I don't have the authority or the data to say, Maggie, you're right, or Maggie, you're wrong. I don't know if they're going to be more or less. History tells us that all of these disruptions create more jobs, that somehow humanity has managed over time to catch up. But we have a reality right now. The rate of change is far greater than the rate of learning. Organizations and employees and companies are facing changes that are far, far faster and a bigger scale than their ability to adapt to them, which leads to an employability issue. What happens when, in 3 months, we roll out this new system and all the jobs that used to be there have to be redefined and changed because the new system is better, more efficient, blah, 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 blah. And half of the employees adapt and the others don't. Or we don't need those half. It's not that over time we couldn't reemploy them. It's that the rate, the speed of change is faster than the speed of adaptation. So to your question, Paul, who owns that? Categorically, I think business leaders and corporations should own it a lot more and should be doing a lot more. And the budgets for training and reskilling have been shrinking, and it's an absolute abomination. It shouldn't be the case. It's frankly very scandalous. I think we have had reorganizations and closures of plants and offices without any thought to the local community and the impact, but that's just my perspective. Looking at data, the countries that are doing this best are the ones where you have public and private partnership, where you have competent administrators and competent business leaders working together. So you look at the German model, the Korean model, you basically have countries that sit down and say, what do we want our employees, our workers to learn? What are the things that our workforce, which are our citizens, need to be prepared for, and they prepare well in advance and have programs to accomplish that. I think in the United States, we could do a lot better in that area.
Yeah, I want to jump in there because Fabio is correct. Like I think workforce budgets for retraining is at a 30-year low. And I've always been perplexed at this discussion in the business press where businesses say we need more well-trained people, but then we're not retraining or helping with that training dimension ourselves. So there's kind of a tension there. The other point that I would like to point out, and this is a piece of data, I would say for maybe 4 out of the last 5 years, I've given the students in my MBA class a question where I tell them, okay, there are 3 million jobs in trucking in the US, trucking and delivery. And suppose self-driving trucks, as Maggie brought up, are introduced and this eliminates half the jobs. And then I ask them, who's responsible for this retraining effort? Is it the employee themselves? Is it the company? Or is it some kind of government safety net? And the vast majority of students say it's the employee's responsibility. And I think that that worldview needs to change. And we need to, as Fabio was saying, whether it's partnership, public-private partnerships between business and government, or whether it's businesses realizing that in order to have an employable, redeployable workforce, they need to pony up and make some investments in human capital. Something has to give there, because there's a lot of attention that's being paid to what universities are doing. Like, universities need to be the human resource departments of major corporations. Universities need to be the ones that are sacrificing liberal arts in order to train the next generation of workers. There's a really fascinating conversation to have around retraining and reskilling. I think the time where we separate people in our minds between tech people and non-tech people is gone. I think everybody is a technology person now. That doesn't mean everybody needs to be a coder. It does mean that everybody needs to understand changing technology, what these technologies can and cannot do. The idea that we have an IT department inside a company and it's somehow separate from everybody else in the organization, I think we got to get over that. And we need to realize that everybody needs to be a technology person now, and you can't avoid it.
Yeah. Maggie Flynn, with regards to retraining and reskilling, is there any room, is there need for policy and regulations in the area or international organizations to come up with guidelines, approaches? How do we think of this?
Shall I go, Maggie?
Sure.
So the short answer is yes, but we need to go far beyond oversight mechanisms and to step way back. And, you know, for example, just to kind of start us off, we're looking at late stage capitalism in America. The system isn't broken. It was designed to work this way only for certain people at the top, certainly not for the workers at the bottom. And so when we're talking about this idea of the future, reskilling, retraining, first of all, yes, it should be, you know, everyone's right to be able to have this agency and opportunity for, as Jason said, dignity. So when we're talking about dignity as this basic, you know, thing we all deserve, we need to design the policies around that. And it's not just about, you know, even though that's very much a part of integrating the IT team with the rest of the company. It's about paid sick leave. It's about paid, you know, parental leave. It's about designing policies so that there is a pipeline, because of course it's not a pipeline issue. It's a way to get people in leadership positions so that we're designing policies to reflect the lived experiences. So representative democracy is supposed to represent who we are. And of course it doesn't. And that's everything from politics to not just, and this is the critical difference between diversity and inclusion and representation. It's not just about having diversity on your team, it's who's on your board, who's in a leadership position, who's making that decision to translate dignity into policy. And that's so incredibly critical because we need that intention, as Fabio said, intention. That's how we kind of start, but we end with action. We end with policies and with oversight mechanisms and with thinking about antitrust for a new age, but also for ideas that haven't even come up yet in terms of the new technologies we're building. You know, there's a lot of discussion that the politics doesn't keep pace. And that is very true. I think the deep difference between now and the Industrial Revolution is we had 40 years to assimilate. We're not going to have nearly as much time
as everyone is saying. Mm-hmm. The tools are coming so fast. So when we're talking about reskilling and retraining, I think that is we have to have a holistic approach. Public-private partnerships have worked all around the world. Ask a Canadian what they think about taxes, and they will say something completely different than what they think about Americans. What Americans think about taxes, even though it's the same principle. So we need to look around the world. As Fabio said, Korea has design solutions, Singapore, Germany, there are answers all around the world. And I think the metaphor is so, so real, because when we're talking about a global pandemic, climate collapse, the future of automation, just being online, these are things that cross boundaries. So we can't just talk about business. We can't just talk about politics. It's all intertwined. It is going to take all of us. And we need to think about the solutions that are already out there. But going beyond the policy solutions that we already have, how are we thinking about moving into the future so that we have a livable planet, so that we can even have these conversations? And I think that policy and that action is so critical, because it's that imperfect first step. We are humans. We are deeply flawed. We have to really recognize that. We're all biased. Everyone is biased in many, many different ways. And so I think shaping those policies so that they reflect dignity is the key. And there are solutions. Other countries have come up with a lot of creative partnerships and collaborative approaches. There are some incredible things that have worked. And I do think we really need to recognize that within the current system that we're in, you know, we have a quarterly report system, profits based on the quarterly report. We have to move beyond that to be able to moving towards dignity and towards dealing with things like bias. And that does come with those oversight mechanisms, those regulations, but also moving beyond it. So in the future, we have more people in the room that are able to discuss those solutions so that we understand not just that we're building something new, but within a framework that protects and invests in all of us.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. I realize I'm learning more, but I feel more ignorant because I realize there's so much more. So Maggie, this is a very big question and it's an unfair question, but so how do we govern AI?
Well, I will say on that one, I'm actually more optimistic. So just because there's been so much work done in the last even 3 years of in different countries, including the United States, of interdisciplinary and intersectorial groups coming together with huge stakeholders and really building out some good models. I mean, Fabio also already mentioned, you know, several key principles. So in general, ideas about transparency, bias, privacy, security, reliability, there, you know, several of these sort of broad principles that are gaining consensus and being built out, right? Because those are the umbrella concepts, and then you have to operationalize them. But so I'm more encouraged now than I was 3 years ago, for sure, on a public awareness that we're in trouble. We're behind the curve. Anyway, some metaphor is relevant there. We're behind. We need to catch up fast. It's urgent. We've seen enough cases now that are deeply worrisome. And so it's got people's attention. And I've been very impressed with a lot of the work that's been done there.
Thanks. So we've got, I think, 8 minutes left, and I've still got a ton of questions. So let's do two things. First, let's talk a little bit about Georgetown. We're all Georgetown people here. So given all we've been talking about, you know, our students go out in the workforce, they're going to deal with AI, they're going to make policy, they're going to influence decisions as practitioners or public servants in every various ways. What should Georgetown be doing now to best prepare our students for a technology intensive, AI intensive world? Maggie, do you want to start? And then let's each one of you, I would love to hear from you.
Yeah, and so I'll be short, but I'm very excited and had mentioned to the other panelists recently, Georgetown has a new integrated major that we're proposing and is making its way through curricular approval in computer science, ethics, and society, so that the people who code are also trained deeply in ethical, legal, social implications of what they're doing, as well as a new interdisciplinary minor for those who don't want to code at all but really want to learn a lot about those ethical, legal, social implications, maybe the future lawyers. So we've designed something we think is really cool. Watch this space. We'll keep people updated as it goes through curricular approval, but pretty excited about Georgetown helping to lead at designing ethical solutions here.
We're excited. Jason?
Yeah, I'm going to go with a little bit more of a primitive thing here. I mean, I think one of the things that we've discussed is the need to have lifelong learning and the need to just have a curiosity about the world around you and how your world is changing. And I really want Georgetown to do a better job of finding and connecting with students at the level to where they want to continually learn, just out of curiosity, out of basic human nature. Not learn because there's an exam or a quiz that's coming up, but actually find something in their life that they're just naturally curious about and just can't stop wanting to know more about it. Or looking around them and seeing, gosh, you know, the nature of work is changing or the nature of society's interactions are changing. Why is this the case? And what can I do to help understand that and to socialize that with my friends and teach other people? That's what I really would like Georgetown to do, is to find and connect with people's creativity and inspiration and motivation to learn forever. Learn and learn and learn and help other people around them learn as well. Because folks that don't go to Georgetown, maybe they don't like learning as much as people that do go to Georgetown. That's my shameless plug for Georgetown. So sometimes Georgetown graduates need to help people from other lesser institutions learn how to learn. And I want everybody who's listening to be inspired by that and learn how to learn and keep learning and help those around you also learn.
Well, I'm glad we've got mostly Georgetown people on this webinar, but I like that plug. Flynn, what do you think?
So, hello to all the students on the call. We did a book event for my book on campus last year, and didn't surprise me at all that the most vibrant, exciting, tough questions, of course, come from students. And I also connected online during the pandemic. I played soccer at Georgetown with the team there, and students and these athletes, you give me so much hope in the future. That is what gives me hope. Your questions, your tough questions, your leadership, your global citizenship. And to add to what has been said about curiosity and these incredibly critical interdisciplinary connections between humanities, ethics, science, political science, is the future of education, something I certainly talk about a lot in my book and otherwise, and it's exciting to see these initiatives cropping up. I actually, guess what course at Georgetown I quote in my book? Problem of God. And I go into a lengthy segment about the critical, courageous conversations across not just disciplines, faiths, and different backgrounds, and from the global north and the global south, different ages, abilities. This is the key to understanding, again, that vast prismatic diversity of who we are. And we learn so much in the classroom, but we learn so much on the field and in study abroad and connecting with people on Red Square, and these ability to have these kind of serendipitous, and what I talk about in the book, combinatorial creative ideas. So melding different disciplines and being so curious, not just about who we are, but connecting with others across these divides. I think that's so critical. And yes, having that great privilege of being in the classroom is so important, but it's really figuring out who we are and critically, how can we serve others? So that concept of service and of being a citizen of our campus, of our world, is so critical, because again, everything from climate to terrorism and bioterrorism, to the future of automation, to the future of work, it's crossing divides. We have to meet each other there, and we have to be building things. And I'll just say this critical piece that I thought about at Georgetown that I learned there and that I think about every day is, what star could we reach if we were building things that we ourselves would never see? What good could we do when we thought about not what's going to benefit us, but what we're going to build to the next generations, what we'd be proud to leave for the next generations of Hoyas and our world writ large?
Thanks, Flynn. And Fabio, you have the last word, but I am going to ask you for a prediction. If we transport ourselves 10 years ahead, and we've got really like a minute or so I'm going to say, give me one good prediction in terms of AI and work. But Fabio, go ahead.
I will give you the two wishes for Georgetown that are also predictions. I wish Georgetown developed some of these partnerships with businesses and business leaders outside to solve for both the AI governance problem and the employability problem, and to do it in a way that fosters and facilitates discussions between business leaders in the academic world and government, and to do it in a way that solves for employability. I think these are two huge problems. They're tightly connected. Georgetown should be and could be a catalyst to solve those. And my prediction is that at least in one of these two areas, Georgetown will play that role in a big way.
I think so too. Flynn, Maggie, Jason, any quick prediction? So you can say I told you so a few years from now? No?
Vaccine is coming. That's my prediction.
That's one we're very grateful for. But thank you all so much. This has been a wonderful, far-ranging conversation. I think we should do this every year or every 6 months because so much is changing. I definitely feel a little better educated than when I started. I'm sure our audience does as well. So thank you all so much. And let's keep meeting and let's keep chatting and let's keep learning, to Jason's point. Sarah, over to you.
Thank you.
A huge thank you to all of our amazing panelists and our incredible moderator. I'm clapping here at home. I hope you all are also. I wish we could be in person so that we could applaud you all together. This has been truly amazing. So thank you so much to our panel for your time. Thanks to our incredible audience for your questions and your attention. Be on the lookout for the webinar follow-up email, which will have the link to the recording of this session. And thanks for being with us. Tune into future ACS webinars and stay in touch. Wishing everyone a wonderful, safe rest of the week.
Hoya saksa.
Hoya saksa. Bye, everyone.